Hi, welcome to The Horn, a podcast from International Crisis Group. I'm Alan Boswell. Kenya and Somalia are currently fighting out a legal case over their ocean border, known to many as the Kenya-Somalia maritime dispute. Somalia has sought investors to explore oil and gas off the coast of their border, territory that Kenya believes is rightfully theirs. Kenya has responded sharply, expelling the Somali ambassador and cutting off direct flights to the country. Many worry the dispute could further destabilize Somalia and the region. To walk us through all this, we have Rashid Abdi. Up until just recently, Rashid was the Horn of Africa director for Crisis Group, which means that Rashid was also my boss. So it's our great pleasure to have him back with us here on the Horn. Rashid, welcome to the podcast.
Thank you very much, Alan.
So we've seen relations between Kenya and Somalia deteriorate sharply over the past year. What is the maritime dispute? Can you explain that to everyone? And why did it flare up this year specifically?
So this goes back a long way to 2011, when the government, which was in power then in Somalia, began discussions with Kenya about demarcating what was called the continental shelf. Like many places in the world, the maritime border between Kenya and Somalia was not demarcated. So Kenya and Somalia signed a memorandum of understanding that they will find a way to demarcate their maritime borders. What we didn't know then was that the whole affair was being pushed by oil interests, who basically wanted to exploit offshore oil and gas in the Lamu Basin. And so they wanted a clear treaty demarcating the borders between the two countries. In 2012, the president then, Hassan Sheikh, came to Kenya and said, look, here is the memorandum of understanding you signed with the previous government, and clearly we need to demarcate this quite quickly. If not, then we will take this matter to court. At that time, Kenya's calculation was that Somalia probably was not in a state to push this. So they misjudged Somalia's intent. They thought this was just a way of extracting concessions from Kenya, and you know the Somali government was not serious.
Because they saw Somalia as just too weak politically.
Exactly. And I think that played into Kenya's calculation to basically, you know, dismiss the whole affair. Hassan Sheikh felt humiliated. He came actually to Nairobi several times, tried to meet with senior Kenyan officials, but you know he couldn't get access. So I think it was eventually anger that forced and a sense of humiliation which forced his hand. So he took the matter to The Hague, and you know from there it was downhill. Kenya basically decided to up the pressure on Somalia. You know they began imposing aviation restrictions on Somalia's flights from Somalia. They also, I think more importantly, began to impose strict visa regulations for officials who were transiting through Nairobi or wanted to visit Nairobi. I think you have to remember that almost 90% of all, you know, international business on Somalia is actually done here in Nairobi. And so Nairobi is a very important diplomatic hub for Somalia. And that, I think, clearly escalated the tensions between the two countries. The situation is that now the court has decided that it will issue a verdict in June 2020. So Kenya and Somalia basically have until June to try to work out how to resolve these tensions. Kenya's main point, I think, is that they want an out-of-court settlement. Somalia insists that they cannot have an out-of-court settlement until the court decides. So they are not completely closing down the door to dialogue, but they are saying, let's wait for the verdict first. And I think you can understand Somalia's motivation. You know, that strengthens their hand in any future negotiations. And also, more importantly, I think, is the fact that the current Somali government, this is an election year for them. And I think there is nothing more serious for an incumbent president than to be seen to be giving away, you know, a territory, a disputed territory to you know, an adversary or a neighbor who is seen as predatory. Kenya also, I think we have to understand where Kenya is coming from. Kenya says that, look, we deployed thousands of troops to dislodge Al-Shabaab. We liberated the port of Kismayo, which was a major, major revenue earner for you know, the insurgent movement. So, you know, Kenyans say that, look, we shed our blood to liberate your territory, and this is what you do to us. So there is a feeling of deep, you know, sense of grievance against Somalis for betraying that trust and that, I think, sense of solidarity.
So let's look at this closer from both sides. From the side of Somali President Mohammed Farmajo, as you mentioned, Somalia is heading towards an election, possibly next year. How much of this has to do with political reasons, national populism, and how much of this has to do with monetizing oil revenues?
I'm glad you raised those issues, because I think they are very critical to understanding what is going on. And also, they interconnect, they intersect. And I think, first of all, Somalia is headed to an election in 2020/2021. The kind of elections which Somalia is going to have, we don't know. But clearly, the current president intends to run. And I think this is why he's playing hardball. He comes from a constituency which has a nationalistic streak, you know, so believes in a strong, assertive Somalia. And this is also some of the, I think, subtext which one needs to understand, that he is also playing to a very domestic, his core support base, which wants to be see Somalia as a strong state which is asserting itself. I think there is nothing more disastrous if he were seen to be, you know, caving in to pressure from a regional state. So this crisis is actually driven a lot by that dynamic.
And that's essentially Somali nationalism.
Somali nationalism, exactly. And then on the other side of Kenya, you also have something similar. You have a country that feels it is a regional power. It has a very vibrant and a larger economy and has deployed troops to Somalia and would not want to be seen as, you know, caving into little Somalia, you know. So there is this, I think, ego grudge match between the two states, which also makes the situation more combustible.
How did we get to this point, really? It seems like in some ways Kenya, you know, seeing itself as the stronger partner, should have been able possibly to ward this off. And of course, Somalia has possibly put itself in quite a difficult position, because Kenya does have a lot of leverage over Somalia, given how much Somali elite and businessmen use Nairobi as a hub. Did both sides just overplay their cards, or how did we get here?
Yes, I think there were a series of missteps, especially, I mean, on all sides. On the Kenyan side, I think you had basically a thinking or a view that Somalia is not going actually to see through the entire process, and that we can twist them, or we can put pressure on them and they will pull back. I think they completely misread Somali politics, and they completely, I think, downplayed the impact of domestic, you know, nationalistic sense will have in really escalating this matter. On the other side, I think also the Somalis I think overplayed the crisis instead of engaging in this matter pragmatically, finding ways in which they can engage the Kenyans. They actually also let some of the more hardline nationalistic elements to actually take over the narrative. It no longer was a maritime dispute. It became actually a much bigger problem. We have a predator neighbor that wants to destroy Somalia. So it played into the old historical grievances which Somalis have always had against Kenya.
One interesting fact that is a bit difficult to overlook is that the president of the International Court of Justice at the moment is a Somali national. Is that just a coincidence, or did that play into President Farmajo's thinking?
Well, if you listen to some of the comments from the Kenyan media, and even, you know, sometimes the officials, the sense is that this is a rigged system. It is also what drives the skepticism, but also the feeling that the system is against us. On the other side, I think the Somalis are proud that they have a president, but I don't think their argument is that, look, this is a professional court. It has, in any case, there is a panel of judges who will decide, and it will be voted, you know, it will be open to vote. So there is no, I think, they tend to downplay the argument that this is a system that has been is a verdict that's going to favor. But I think you are right. This is also part of the complicating factor in the whole court case.
Now, implicit in Somalia's strategy here seems to be that they think the court might give them a favorable ruling, and the way Kenya's responded also seems to indicate that they're quite worried about the legal case itself. Why is that? Is there any reason to think that Somalia is on stronger grounds here legally?
I have looked at some of the technical details on this. It is very complicated, and I can understand why the court has taken this long to actually reach a verdict. It is a very complicated case, and there are geological, you know, issues. There are actually maritime issues. There are issues of precedent to discuss. Now, if you look at what the Kenyans are, what the Somalis want, is a sort of a diagonal economic zone. Demarcation.
Diagonal from their border.
From their border.
If you kept drawing the border from where it was, it would go diagonally.
Absolutely. I've put it very eloquently. So what happens is that completely shrinks Kenya's access to the sea.
And Kenya wants the border just to be drawn horizontally.
Exactly.
Okay.
So that actually is and I think if you look at the way in which these issues have been settled, there isn't a clear-cut rule. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it has always been open to interpretations. So it is there's no detracting from the fact that it is an exceptionally complicated problem. Then, on top of that, you also have another problem, which is oil and gas. If this was just an ordinary fishing ground, I think you'll have seen a settlement. But the problem again is that you have two countries, poor countries, who are desperate to see the oil and gas offshore, oil and gas, as actually a ticket out of poverty. So I think this is also what has made the situation much more combustible.
One thing that we've heard is a concern that if the International Court of Justice does decide one way or the other, this could have ocean effects, if you will, on the rest of the African Indian Ocean coast, because, of course, many of those same borders haven't really been demarcated for the same way. Do you agree with that?
Yes, and I think this is one of the reasons why the court is very reluctant. Every ICJ ruling creates a precedent. And I think they are very careful, they are cautious, they do a lot of technical checks and all that. I think just talking to various actors, the sense I get is that part of the dilemma is actually very political. What is the court does not want to take a ruling that actually leads to direct conflict. That will reflect very badly on the court. And I think that is why my sense is that eventually the solution will be a fudge, something that creates a very hazy kind of a very elastic regime in which can be interpreted in various ways, and parties will be happy too. And I think we are beginning to see those elements coming into play, in which Kenya and Somalia begin to engage before the election, before the verdict. The verdict comes out, it doesn't create the nuclear catastrophe, and all countries, the two countries begin a process of actually arbitration and some form of revenue sharing or whatever regime works for them.
Relations between Kenya and the Somalia federal government is, of course, complicated for other reasons. As you mentioned, Kenya sent in its troops into Somalia in 2011, and they remain there. And Kenya supports some of the regional states, which they see as essentially buffer zones for security reasons, with Al-Shabaab being so active in southern Somalia. And of course, President Farmajo on the Somali side, obviously wants more of the power to rest in Mogadishu. We saw this flare up earlier this year in Jubaland elections. Is the maritime dispute exacerbating these tensions between Mogadishu and the federal member states, these regional governments, or is this all inevitable anyways?
Indeed, I think that is an excellent question. The impact which the maritime dispute is having on domestic politics, both on both sides of the border. Now, tensions have been building up in recent years between the Somali government and its federal member states. So what has happened is that the bulk of these oil and gas resources lie off the coast of Jubaland, which is a territory which borders Kenya and which historically has been linked to Kenya's northern province, northern northeastern. Clan composition and various historical factors make actually this region not two but one region. You know, so the politics is very much intertwined, and conflicts also tend to spill over. So the contest for Jubaland has actually intensified between Mogadishu and Nairobi. There was an election held recently in which the former incumbent president Sheikh Madobe was re-elected under very controversial circumstances. You know, the opposition entirely boycotted the election. So in the eyes of, I think, Mogadishu, the exercise was illegitimate. And I think tensions have been building up in recent months in Jubaland. Now, from the Kenyan perspective, the return of Madobe is a strategic victory, because not only is he a friendly ally, a friendly leader, but also potentially an ally in case things become complicated in the negotiations over oil and gas, because the oil and gas lie off the coast of Jubaland. So that is also the dynamic I think one needs to understand, that this isn't just two states battling each other over our marine territory. It is actually very much, it is very much complicated by the politics.
Now, of course, the other major player on Somalia for the past several decades has been Ethiopia. And previously, Kenya and Ethiopia, it seems like, sort of shared a policy of supporting the member states, and they cooperated a lot on their Somalia policy. It seems new Prime Minister Abiy Ahmed's taking a different approach and has been quite close and friendly with President Farmajo. How do you see the Ethiopian role playing into this?
Somalia and Ethiopia, Somalia and Kenya, these are three countries that have had very difficult relations, and the relations go back, decades, even centuries. So those historical factors, I think, needs to be aware of them. Now, Abiy, since his emergence, has begun shifting some of the traditional policies of Ethiopia towards Somalia. Somalia is not being entirely viewed in Addis now as a serious internal national security crisis for Ethiopia. In other words, it's not now securitized as it was in the beginning. We are beginning to see Abiy talk much more about economic opportunities, economic integration. He talks a lot about Ethiopia's access to some of the ports in Somalia. So he has shifted the debate from security to economics, and I think that is positive. But where the problem lies, I think, is the way in which also he has shifted very radically as the traditional support for Somalia's federal member states. Now, Meles Zenawi loved federalism, and I think not only did he conceive the idea of ethnic federalism for Ethiopia, but also he favored that system in the neighboring countries. He encouraged Kenya's decentralization. He also did the same thing in Somalia. And both Jubaland and Puntland and even Somaliland, saw in Ethiopia as this strategic, as neighbor who was, supportive of them, but also as a strategic ally in case things became difficult with Mogadishu. But what Abiy has done is to completely pivot towards Mogadishu at the detriment of, these regional states, who now feel they do not have this huge neighbor who look to them with favor. So that has actually complicated also the politics. Also, another, I think, element one needs to understand is that Abiy comes from a different school of thought. He has, according to him, studied the ethnic federal model and actually is against federalism. He wants a strong centralized state.
I mean, we see this over and over again, of course. Most of the focus with what's going on in Ethiopia is focused on internal Ethiopian issues, because those are, of course, massive. But the effects of Abiy's emergence on regional dynamics, I think, is still sort of coming into view. So I imagine Kenya then feels quite on its back foot and almost besieged suddenly if given that Somalia's pushed this case, which they weren't really expecting, and then Ethiopia, which used to be with Kenya and sort of supporting the federal member states, have suddenly pivoted. What are the implications for the region if Kenya and Ethiopia are no longer seeing, you know, eye to eye or are reaching some accommodation on how to engage Somalia and their strategies there?
The whole disruptive impact of Abiy's radical rearrangement of all traditional foreign policy of Ethiopia has, I think, fundamentally shifted or upset some of the, you know, fragile and delicate alliances. Now, Kenya and Ethiopia have had the longest, most resilient, I think, strategic partnership of any two countries in the Horn. And I think while I'm not saying that it is now at a critical, phase and, you know, is really unstable, there's no denying that Abiy's policies have upset that relations, and there is a real palpable sense of anxiety in Nairobi, which also drives some of the escalatory politics, steps which they have taken in recent months. I think the Kenyans cannot read Abiy, whether they can't read him, well. Is he a friend? Is he a foe? And I think that is what is causing some of these tensions we are beginning to see.
It's interesting looking back historically how much Kenyan-Ethiopia cooperation has really been sort of the backbone of some of these regional security initiatives and the sort of settlement within the region. And that was institutionalized in the form of IGAD, which is the regional bloc. And I think one thing that we've seen is very much that Abiy's emergence in Ethiopia has had a lot of effects on that regional settlement, and I think we're still waiting to see sort of how all that shakes out. Now, do you see the Gulf states also playing a role in this with the maritime dispute, or is, because of course the Gulf dispute between the Emiratis and Saudis on one side and the Qataris on the other has had a lot of implications in Somalia, and I don't think we need to get into all of that, but is that also playing a role in this maritime dispute?
I think, first of all, we need to be careful in not seeing everything that happens as actually having a Gulf element to it. But you are right. In this case, you know, this maritime dispute has actually, is beginning to have, elements which are linked to the geopolitics, the wider geopolitics. Qatar, for example, has recently bought 3 of Kenya's oil fields. So they have bought a stake in the 3 oil fields. And this is a very interesting, I think, development, because Qatar is very much the biggest supporter of the Somali federal government. Many of the, Somali politicians are directly linked to Qatar's, patronage networks and systems. So I think Qatar has been trying to maneuver into a position where it is seen as the benefactor both of Kenya and of Somalia. And we saw the foreign minister come to Kenya recently and also visit Somalia. And I think there is a lot of evidence that behind the scenes, the Qataris are interested in some form of a settlement. So Qatar is playing a very clever game in which it is trying to be seen as the tempering hand, as the calming, big brother in all this, which is quite interesting.
Now, to take all these various threads and put them, wind them back together again, there's been various attempts at trying to mediate between President Kenyatta and President Farmajo, including by Prime Minister Abiy, including the U.S. had an initiative to try to mediate between the two. Did any of these find any success?
Success, yes, but very modestly. We are beginning to see less acrimonious language. We are beginning to see less harsh statements between the two sides. We have also begun to see a relaxation of the visa regime at the Jomo Kenyatta International Airport. Flights from Mogadishu no longer fly through Wajir Airport. So all these are very positive, de-escalatory measures. Mm-hmm. The problem, again, lies, I think, in the bigger issues. There is also, I think, another very interesting thing that has happened in recent weeks, which is both countries have actually, for the first time, said that they are going to ring fence their bilateral relations from the maritime dispute. In other words, they are going to make a very deliberate compartmentalization of the situation in which they, the tensions, the maritime tensions, do not then, I think, disrupt their traditional bilateral relations. And I think that's very positive. It is the best pragmatic thing to do. How these two countries then proceed from here, no one knows. Of course, the two leaders met here in Nairobi. There is also, I think, an effort underway by the government of Egypt to try to broker a settlement. Now, Egypt becoming involved also in the maritime dispute also, I think, sends a very bad signal regionally. Mm-hmm. Ethiopia, I think, will not be very happy. Because of the Nile dispute. And I think Kenya needs to be very careful in the way, or rather, these two countries need to be very careful of who they choose as mediator and who they choose as a sort of go-between. Egypt, I mean, I have no problem with Egypt mediating, but probably Egypt is a complicating factor, an aggravating factor in geopolitical terms. And I think, the two probably will at some point need some kind of a neutral, far away, mediator. But I think the critical steps from here is, first of all, to cement and consolidate these de-escalatory measures. Mm-hmm. And I think the Kenyans also need to probably stop putting pressure on Somalia for an out-of-court settlement. It's not going to happen before the verdict. After the verdict, Somalis are very open. And I am sure, 100%, that eventually the two countries will come around a table and find an amicable route out of this, because there is no other choice. Even from a technical perspective, even the oil and gas operators basically say that we cannot operate in a climate where the two countries are hostile, where Somalia doesn't have a navy, and that probably is a strategic gain for, or maybe a strategic leverage for the Kenyans, but it isn't if you consider this is a very tiny territory, and potentially you can disrupt some of the oil rigs by various means. So I think if the two countries continue on this path, which has been started, then the future, I think, are much more optimistic that there will be a settlement.
By what you've said, you don't expect Somalia to really negotiate a final deal until this verdict happens. So what can people do in the interim if policymakers and regional and international actors want to engage this issue? What can be done between now and the case hearing in June?
I think definitely there has been a lot of backroom, back channel diplomacy by the United States government, but also by the Europeans, to try to bring the two countries to some form of. But I think Somalis are very careful. Farmajo does not want to appear as if he has caved in, as if he's now negotiating. And that is why I think you saw in some of his message, he basically said, look, we talked, it's Kenya that gave us concessions. I never gave any concessions. I never promised that I'm going to for an out-of-court settlement. And so there is a need, first of all, I think, to take this from the media limelight to basically, it's not a media contest. And I think, there is now room for some much more discreet diplomacy between the two countries, but also by their friends outside. The key is to consolidate the de-escalatory measures so that we don't have another disruption along the path. My feeling also is that we need to prepare for the post-June verdict. It's not going to be a huge. My feeling is that it is probably going to be a fudge, in which case both countries will have a much more flexibility in finding a settlement. If then it is goes against one party, especially the Kenyans, then probably the hardliners in the Kenyan government may say, look, this is what we expected, and we gave concessions for nothing. And so that, I think, is my fear, that in case, it goes against Kenya, the hawks within the Kenyan administration, will have their hands strengthened, and then we'll be back to square one.
And you do think a win-win solution on this is possible?
A win-win solution is possible, no doubt about it. It's just that, you know, both have boxed themselves into this corner where they can't climb down without losing face, you know. And this is the problem one is familiar with, you know, when you overtalk or escalate rhetoric about the case, then this is eventually what happens. They are basically captives of their own, you know, rhetoric.
Rashid, thanks for coming on our podcast.
Thank you very much, Alan.
Thanks for listening. You can follow Crisis Group on Twitter at Crisis Group or find us online at crisisgroup.org. Once again, I'm Alan Boswell. This episode was produced by Maeve Francis.